Welcome to this second webinar on additive manufacturing. My name is Brecht van Horweder. I am professor at KU Leuven and leading the additive manufacturing team in the mechanical engineering department. Our research focus is on laser and powder-based additive manufacturing techniques, but actually there are a number of different 3D printing techniques available. The idea of this webinar is that I give a short introduction to them. Here you can see a table of different 3D printing technologies that are ordered in terms of the starting phase. You can see, depending if we start from a liquid, a powder material, a solid, or a gas, you can have many different additive manufacturing technologies. For this short presentation, I looked at which of those technologies are typically used in industry. You can see a survey here of selective laser sintering on the left, fused deposition modeling, and stereolithography, so the three first ones in this graph, are widely used for printing of polymers, so we will have a look at them. And for additive manufacturing of metals, which is a more recent domain in additive manufacturing, I selected laser powder bed fusion, electron powder bed fusion, and direct energy deposition. So for printing of polymers and metals, I selected each time three technologies that I will briefly introduce. Be aware that we can already also print ceramics, but those manufacturing technologies can be tackled another time. So let us start with printing of polymers. Printing of polymers exists already for more than 30 years, and the first printing process available was stereolithography, also called SLA. In stereolithography, we actually start from a liquid. We use a photosensitive resin that is put in a bath, as you can see on the graph, and then we use an ultraviolet laser and a scanning mirror that deflects the laser beam onto this liquid resin. When the laser energy interacts with the liquid will solidify and create a solid part. Once a solid layer is created, the platform will lower just a little bit so that new resin can form on top of the printed layer and that the process can repeat itself. Step by step, complex three-dimensional models can be created. There are two processing principles. What you can see on this slide is where we have the resin in a bath and the layer from the laser from the top. This is called top-down or industrial selective stereolithography. Another way of printing with stereolithography is the bottom-up approach and shines to the resin from below. This is a technology that has recently become also commercially available at a much cheaper price, hence the name desktop printers. You can see a typical application of stereolithography here, which is medical modeling. Imagine a surgeon that has to do a very complex brain tumor operation. Of course, it would be good if this surgeon can practice this operation. The idea here is that a scan is made of the patient's head and also the tumor. This head with the tumor in a different color can then be printed using stereolithography so that all the instruments and the actions that will need to be done later can be practiced on the medical model first. In the graph that you see below, you can see that in a number of years we were able to produce or to increase the productivity of this technology by a large amount just by improving the machining concept. So at first you can see production of this skull took 30 hours, while after machine improvements, we were able to get that to below 5 hours. Stereolithography can be easily upscaled. This means we can produce very large parts. An example is given here of a mammoth stereolithography machine that is one of the largest stereolithography machines worldwide that is present in a Belgian company, Materialise. And you can see a Fort Mondeo dashboard or a prototype from that dashboard that is shown here. 2,700 different layers stacked on top of each other, 52 hours of building time. And you can see dimensions, the length is over 2 meters long. So stereolithography is a technique that exists for many years, which are polymers that can be hardened by ultraviolet laser interaction. Many different resins are existing depending on the application. Transparent resins, rubber-like resins, or ceramic filled resins that have higher stiffness. Some characteristics of this 3D printing technology is that we can use very thin layers. This means that the surface quality of these parts is generally high, and the surface is also very smooth. For prototyping that need a good aesthetic, this technology is very suitable. A typical layer thickness is between 25 and 150 micrometers, and this also links directly to the high accuracy that we can reach. As mentioned before, some of the different technologies for this stereolithography are already available commercial, such as the Formlabs 3 printer that you can see on the bottom right. One of the disadvantages of this technology is that the parts that are being produced are quite brittle, and so in many cases not suitable for real functional objects, but rather for prototyping uses. Printing goes relatively fast compared to the two other printing technologies that we will see later. And another disadvantage is that support structure is needed. Imagine you want to print, for instance, this geometry. We have some overhanging features, so down-facing surfaces, and for these features, we would have to print support structures that have to be removed after printing. Not all 3D printing technologies require the printing of support structure, so that is definitely a disadvantage of this technique. The last disadvantage is that the resins themselves are quite sticky and messy to work with. There are some new technologies emerging on the market, for instance, technology where you can just use liquid crystal displays instead of the more expensive UV lasers. Those displays are also put below the liquid resin and can make stereolithography very fast and less expensive. So in general, these technologies are mostly used for medical modeling and prototyping and not for functional objects. The second technology for processing plastics is fused deposition modeling, also called fused filament fabrication. As you can see on this slide, it starts with a very thin filament of polymer that is fed through a nozzle. In the nozzle, this filament will melt to a semi-molten state that can then be deposited on a base plate. Either the nozzle or the base plate can move in X, Y, and Z direction, and by programming the machine, you can then print complex parts. Imagine also with this technology, support structure is needed when you want to print overhanging surfaces. Those technologies are mainly used for thermoplastic polymers, so thermosoftening polymers that become flexible when you heat them and that solidify upon cooling. Some examples are shown here, so typically with FDM, you can process quite a range of different plastics, including PLA, ABS, high-density polyethylene, polyamide, but also more heat-resistant polymers, such as ULTEM. So in summary, FDM is a highly popular additive manufacturing technique due to its low cost and ease of use. Many cheap printers are available, such as, for instance, the MarketBot Replicator, which are printers that can also be used by students or by hobbyists or architects, and that not necessarily are expensive, nor that they can produce very functional parts in the end. A big advantage is that the parts that are printed with this technology are actually quite strong and can be used for mechanically loaded applications. This is in contrast with the parts that we can produce with SLA, as discussed before. Printing takes quite a lot of time. This is a disadvantage. You can imagine you have to move the nozzle or the platform around, and this takes more time than just switching a mirror to move a laser beam. And as mentioned, support material is needed. Layer thickness is typically higher than with stereolithography, and this leads, of course, to visible layer lines. I have an example of an FDM part that you can see here. If you would look closely with the naked eye, you would be able to see the printing layers very clearly. And this, of course, gives rise to a quite rough surface that in many cases needs to be post-processed. The last disadvantage is that we produce the part layer by layer, and especially with FDM, we can see that mechanical properties in different directions are not equal. This is what we call anisotropic material behavior, and this has to be taken into account when using FDM parts in real life. So, to summarize, for prototyping, manufacturing aids, and low volume end-use parts, we can use FDM processing. The last technique for printing of polymers is selective laser sintering, or SLS. And this is quite similar to SLM that is used for metals. What you can see here is that we start from a very thin layer of powder, and we will use a CO2 laser and a scanner to shine with the laser on the powder on specific locations. Where the laser interacts with the powder will sinter and melt and will create solid material. This way we can build layer by layer and create three-dimensional parts. An example of such a part is, for instance, this plastic turbine blade or this footsole, which has a porous structure below to have a certain stiffness at specific locations. And these are good examples of parts that can actually be used in practice and that are being used in a large scale already. SLS is mainly used for nylons or polyamides and can also be used for TPUs, for polypropylene or for polystyrene. But the market is actually dominated by polyamide 12, and this is also a disadvantage of this technology. It's less easy to process many different polymers with this technology. The cost is also quite high because you need the CO2 laser and quite a complex machine. The mechanical performance, on the other hand, is very good. For some applications, we can even reach the same mechanical behavior as conventionally produced plastics. In the machine is also powder bed preheating that is necessary to reduce the shrinkage of the part after production. And this also leads to some advantages. Before the laser interacts with the powder is already preheated and sintered or connected slightly to each other. This means that even for printing overhanging structures, we don't need to print support structures, because the powder that is not molten is sintered together by the preheating and has some kind of support or load-bearing capacity. This has, of course, a lot of advantages. We don't need to print support structures. And we can also put many parts on top of each other when we do one print job. This is called nesting, and you can see an example on the top right of this slide, where you can see that the printer is actually optimized to print as many complex geometries as possible at the same time. Layer thickness is between 60 to 150 micrometers, so typically the layers are not so visible by the naked eye, and the surface quality is acceptable, but of course a lot worse than with stereolithography and a little bit better compared to FDM. So to summarize, SLS is a widely used technology in industry for printing mainly polyamide 12, for manufacturing aids, low volume end-use parts, and customized medical applications, such as, for instance, these foot soles. Here you can see an overview of some different polymers that can be processed with the technology. And this is, of course, interesting, because the more polymers you can process, the more potential applications you can cover. So far for 3D printing of polymers, and we mentioned just three widely used techniques for that, let us now go to 3D printing of metals. This is a bit a more challenging area, because if you want to melt metals, you can imagine you need high complex and more expensive. In this webinar, I will cover three of the most widely used technologies for printing of metals. This is laser powder bed fusion, also called SLM, or selective laser melting, electron powder bed fusion, or EBM, electron beam melting, and direct energy deposition, DED, also called laser cladding. Let us start with selective laser melting. A thin layer of powder is spread, similar like the selective laser sintering process for polymers. In this case, another laser is used with higher power and a different wavelength, so that we can actually melt metal. Where the laser interacts with the powder bed, the metal will melt and solidify, leading to a solid. If we repeat this layer by layer, we can create a three-dimensional metal part. You can see another example here of a ring and many other parts that are printed on a solid steel base plate, where in this case we needed to print some support structure for the overhanging surface that needs to be removed in a second step. You can also see in the middle picture of the ring that the surface of the ring is actually not so smooth, surface roughness is typically between 5 and 10 micrometers, so in many cases the surface has to be polished or machined. To summarize some of the characteristics of this technique, in general, what we do is use a laser beam to melt layers of powder together. Typically, we have a quite good surface finish compared to other metal manufacturing techniques, and we can process a broad range of materials. On the right-hand side, you can see a cross-section of a cooler where you can see internal cooling channels that can be printed with complex geometry and that can lead to better performance of this part. The building process is relatively slow compared to other manufacturing methods. And another disadvantage is that residual stresses can build up easily in the parts. This means that parts can deform after printing and that in many cases specific heat treatments are needed after printing. There are many applications for this technology, including medical applications, dental, automotive, aerospace, general machinery, and mechanical components, and more. Here you can see an overview of some commercial and in-house machines of this technology that is available at KU Leuven, and you can see these machines typically range from 50,000 euros to more than 1 or 2 million in price. So this is typically a technology that is not used by the hobby user, but more by industrial users or researchers. Second technology for processing metals is electron powder bed fusion, also called electron beam melting or EBM. As you can see in the image, in this case, not a laser is used, but an electron beam. And this electron beam will first sinter the powder, a little bit like the infrared preheating with selective laser sintering. And when the powder is sintered, then the real electron beam will melt the powder at specific locations, creating three-dimensional geometries layer by layer. The sintering of the powder is needed to avoid powder flowing around in the build chamber, and it has some advantages and disadvantages. One of the advantages is that, as you can see on the bottom left picture, you create some kind of a cake of sintered powder in which the printed parts are present. So you have to remove this before you can take out the real parts. This is an additional step that is needed. It's less easy to recycle the powder. And also a disadvantage is that part of the sintered powder is still sticking to the surface of the printed parts. So surface roughness is typically a lot worse than for selective laser melting. And in many cases, also as you can see here, for this part of a hip implant, post-processing technologies are needed. The pre-sintering of the powder also has advantages. One of the advantages is that you typically do not use support structure, or at least less support structure than for SLM, because the sintered powder can carry the load. And also because of the preheating, the thermal gradients that are building up during printing are less pronounced, and so the deformation and the residual stresses for this technology are lower. All of this is also summarized in this slide, so less support is needed, residual stresses are lower, the layer build process is relatively fast, and an additional advantage is that we use also vacuum for processing. These advantages include the high surface roughness, the fact that we cannot reuse the powder so easily, and also that we have a limited amount of different materials available to process with this technology. In practice, EBM is mostly used for medical and dental applications in titanium or cobalt chromium. The last technique for printing metals is direct energy deposition, or DED, also called laser cladding. In this technology, we will not start from a powder bed, but we will use a nozzle. In the nozzle, there will be a flow of powder particles and a laser beam in the middle. The laser beam will melt the powder particles on top of an existing part or a base plate. It's to call this technology, as you can see on the slide here. So basically, powder is sprayed through a nozzle and melted in the focal point of a laser that goes through the same nozzle. This technology is quite fast and can be used to process very large parts. It can also be used for repair. Imagine a very big part with a small crack. If the crack can be machined away, then this hole can be filled again using direct energy deposition, which is of course economically interesting. It's suited for very large components and for a broad range of materials, even gradient materials, where we use different chemical compositions at different locations. The disadvantages are that the accuracy is quite low, the layers are very thick and can be seen with the naked eye, and so in many cases post-machining is required. Also, no overhanging structures are typically possible. So in practice, this technology is mainly used for repairs and for very large components. You can see a more recent development here where a machine was built that integrates both direct energy deposition or laser cladding together with a more conventional subtractive machining. So a part can be built using additive manufacturing, but we know that one of the disadvantages is the poor surface quality, but we can solve that by using the conventional machining or milling to make the surface of the part smoother. And by combining the advantages of those both technologies, we can have a solution that is much more economically interesting than the conventional or the new techniques on their own. So this concludes my very short overview of three popular technologies for printing polymers and for printing metals. Thank you.